إن لله عبادا فطنا طلقوا الدنيا وخافوا الفتنا نظروا فيها فلما علموا أنها ليست لحي.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا كريم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. Dear brothers and sisters, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless this gathering, this short gathering on a short notice. And I ask first and foremost the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and your forgiveness if I upset anyone with anything. Of course, this life, subhanAllah, is a very fast-paced life. And I grew up in this community. If you guys can please come forward. And of course, I've interacted with many of you, and I might have upset some of you, willingly or unwillingly. So I ask you to forgive me before I leave. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you as you forgive me, as the Prophet has said in the hadith, Ar-Rahimuna yarhamu Ar-Rahman, yarhamu man fil ard, yarhamu man fis sama. That those who have mercy, Allah will have mercy upon them. Have mercy on those who are on earth, and Allah, the one who is in heaven, will have mercy on you. So I ask you again to please forgive me if I upset anyone with anything. And I try sometimes, if I remember, to approach you and ask forgiveness. Sometimes it works, sometimes it don't. SubhanAllah. But we will not enter Jannah till we settle our issues. SubhanAllah. So it's better we settle it here than before. طيب. As my stay here was quite short, and as life is short, SubhanAllah, the best words that I can find to start this talk was from the poet. His name is Abu Bakr Muhammad, who was a Maliki jurist, and he says in a very beautiful poem, إن لله عبادا فطنا طلق الدنيا وخاف الفتنة نظروا فيها فلما علموا أنها ليست بحي وطنا جعلها لجة واتخذوا صالح الأعمال فيها سفنا. It's a very beautiful poem that sums up, subhanAllah, the life of the Muslim who has understood his purpose in life. And as Al-Muhasibi says, I believe, رَأَيْتُ النَّاذِرِينَ قَدْ فَحِمُ مَعْنَ الْوُجُودِ, that very seldomly did I see people who truly understood the intent or the purpose, true purpose of this creation, of this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this life for a purpose. And a lot of people seem to think that this life is very long. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, that I did not create the jinn, the spirits, and the human beings except that they should worship. And this worship has too many different branches. It's not just sitting in the masjid and making sujood and ruku' and qiyam. It has many things. And one of them, it is the da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I have to say that I have been in this community for quite a long time. And then I left. And when I came back, I have seen an amazing system, an amazing program. Jazakallah khair for the Shaykh, who has, mashallah, done so much in this little time. And this is very, very important. But he is only one man. And he cannot just do everything by himself. And alhamdulillah, we see usually the same brothers who are involved. 10 brothers, you can really count them on your fingers, doing the same work. So you'll find Brother Kevin doing like 10 things. Youth club, this, that, and computer. And sometimes it becomes too much. And then you find other brothers who are doing other things. And again, it becomes a lot sometimes. And I found, alhamdulillah, that there is a lot of da'wah, but this kind of da'wah is called islah. Okay, this is to Muslims, programs to Muslims to improve the stature and the stature of the Muslims in our community. And subhanAllah, especially with the youth, it is amazing. It is really, really amazing. But the da'wah ila islam, the da'wah to Islam has been, from what I've seen, reduced. And maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong. But it seems that it's been reduced a bit. And as a community, we are not approaching and inviting our non-Muslim colleagues and friends and neighbors that much to Islam, to what is Islam. And we are here in a non-Muslim country. And we are here and we have a responsibility. Of course, many people have migrated from different Muslim countries to come here for a better living, sometimes because of necessity. And no one's going to debate the validity of that. Sometimes because they're forced to, because they cannot worship properly in their countries. SubhanAllah. And they have come to this country. But there's others, and many actually, who come here without any pressure really. They come here seeking a better life. And alhamdulillah, they come to the masjid, they pray. But there's a responsibility on their shoulder. It is not enough just to come and seek a better living, or a better job, or better schooling for our children. It is not enough. Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in, whenever they have gone to any Muslim land, any non-Muslim lands, they always carry the banner of Islam with them, the da'wah. Be it in their manners. No one tells anyone that you have to sit in front of a microphone and talk to people, or that necessarily you have to go and knock at the doors. Not everyone has to do these things. There are some people who are very good at that and they should do these things. But no one should say, well, I don't know how to speak, or I don't know, I don't have too much ilm, or I'm not good in front of the camera, or I cannot go for tabligh or something to knock at people's doors, anything like that. No one is saying that you should do this or that. There's people doing different things. But the question is, what can you do? What can you do as a Muslim in a non-Muslim country, inviting, living here, enjoying the benefits of this country, while people next to us are non-Muslims? They don't know about La ilaha illallah, or what they know about Islam is very distorted from the media. And just recently, I want to bring to everyone's attention, there's been a program on Channel 4 about Islam by a very infamous so-called scholar who has totally taken Islam for right, misquoting and totally destroying the image of Islam, saying that there's no historical validity for Islam, all the ahadith are fabricated, the Quran, Mecca is not even mentioned in the Quran, all of these ludicrous things. And look at this guy, he can sit there and be watched by millions of people and he is speaking for Islam. So where are we? Where are we defending Islam? Where are we portraying Islam in its right, proper manner? Where are we standing up and saying, this guy is wrong? Actually, the weakest hadith that we have, the weakest hadith, da'if, it is more authentic than the Bible itself. Do you know that? Do you know that the weakest hadith we have in Islam, it is more authentic than the Bible itself? The whole Bible, combine all the four Gospels, plus all the letters of Paul and so on, then our weakest hadith in Islam, it is more authentic than all of these combined together. From a historical point of view. Actually, if we were to apply Islamic standards to hadith, and what is hadith? It's a speech, it's a narration. If we were to apply, for example, Ilmul Rijal to any book or any program that is out there, just based on the reputation of the people who are speaking, it would be rejected. Because these people are not outright righteous people. It would be rejected. Imagine that. It wouldn't even pass the first little criteria. But we have non-Muslims speaking for Islam and telling other people what Islam is. So where are we? Why are we not giving down? We get busy in our lives. We're working 8 to 5, 9 to 4, whatever the time might be. We come home tired. And sometimes we feel like we're the lower hand. Sometimes, I feel that the same. I'm not talking just to you. Sometimes it's very hard to start talking to someone about Islam, to a non-Muslim. They're very hard to approach. And this is why the reward of someone being guided by your hand is so great. Because the struggle, following in the path of the Anbiya, inheriting their work, it is one of the most rewarded works in this life. And also one of the most difficult things to do. And people will be against you, without a doubt. I've made many enemies since I've been calling people to Islam. This is the way it is. It's a price that we have to pay. But we have a responsibility. And we are here in a non-Muslim country with millions of people not knowing La ilaha illallah. And we say, but I don't know anything to say about it. I don't know what to say anything. But we know from the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Convey from me, even if it's one ayah. We have one strong ayah that we can give to everyone. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. No one can argue with that. Any person who somehow believes in some type of concept of a creator or God, be it a polytheistic, or they call it monotheistic, which is usually not, but they cannot argue with Qul Huwa Allah Ahad, with the concept of Allah. And that's where we have to bring the people to. To the first thing we need to talk to. We in a non-Muslim country, we usually, when we engage with people, with non-Muslims about Islam, what would it be about? They would say, why do women wear hijab? Why can men have, ta'ayyuz zawjat? Why can people do this and that? Why is 9/11? These are the kind of topics that people bring up, right? So we, right away from the start, we get into a defensive position. We actually have to cut it right at that spot. And we need to tell them, I can explain to you these things, but will you become Muslim if I answer these questions? Most people are not going to do that. But you can say, I can tell you these things. But first, let me tell you, before you can understand, for example, hijab or polygamy or so on, let me tell you who has decreed these laws. Let me tell you about Allah. Because you will not understand why a woman has to wear hijab till you understand who said that. So, do you have 5-10 minutes that I can tell you first about who is Allah and what is His speech, the Quran? And from this is the way to do it. And we can bring them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to understand who is Allah. This is proper da'wah. This is when we say subhanAllah, we look at the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We look at the da'wah of the Sahaba and the early Salaf. We find find that this is the way they invited to Allah, with hikmah. We don't want to put ourselves in a defensive position. Why should we? We have nothing to defend. We need to be on the offensive. And we need to tell people about Allah. Every single person who has said, La ilaha illallah, it becomes some kind of obligation on them. Whether it be that, for example, a woman supports her husband and does not cause him harm and problems when he gives da'wah. She supports him morally, spiritually, financially, whatever it is. Or she herself can have many ways of doing da'wah. Or that a man might not be able to speak in front of a mic, but he can support an organization, he can support a da'i, he can write a book, he can start a page. There's too many ways that this can be done. Many, many ways. But first and foremost, do we have the niyyah? Do we even have the intention to do that? This is the question. Because if we don't, and we are in a non-Muslim country, this is a big problem actually. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to ask us, okay, so what did you do? What did you do? And we know the hadith of the, and I'm not going to say that, but we know the hadith of the worshipper, the pious worshipper, who was in the city. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the angels to destroy the city. And they said, there's a slave of yours, Allah, who is worshipping him. Allah said, start with him. He didn't tell the people that what they're doing is wrong. He didn't invite the people to the truth. It's a big thing. Do we have the niyyah? And as Umar Khattab has reported from Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى, that every deed is according to intention. And everyone will have what they intended. So, this is a very deep question actually we have to ask ourselves, our families, and everyone else. We can sit around and pick, for example, the Qur'an, and we'll find many, many verses about da'wah. And the whole life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he lived in da'wah. He lived in da'wah. All the sahabas lived in da'wah. People would say, well, that was at that time. You know, we have different system now, different issues, different things. Of course, we have to use hikmah. No one's saying that, you know, we need to do a very harsh da'wah. We need to use, actually, the one thing that we can say that we learned from the Sirah of Rasulullah and the most important thing is how to be a wise person. How to use wisdom. How to understand a certain situation and be able to isolate the situation and apply a certain ruling on this and not on another one, for example. They might be similar but with some different details. Not to just go and just blanket everything and say, we're just going to do this for everything. Wallahi, this never happened in the life of Prophet. For each situation was a perfect response and a perfect way of dealing with. To the point that people used to come to him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they used to ask him the same question and they used to get two different responses. SubhanAllah. And people might say, oh, why did he give two different responses? This is hikmah. He understood that this person, he cannot hold himself, for example, when the person came and asked about kissing your wife when you fast. And he understood that this person is a young person. And he told him, for you, no. For the elder one, the one who can control his desire more. For you, yes, it's okay. Look at this, two, same question, two different answers. And many other different things. This is hikmah, he taught us hikmah. And this hikmah is very, very important in da'wah. We need to use it. So there are many verses. There are many verses in the Quran, many verses. I'm going to take only a couple verses from the Quran that talk about da'wah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِ اُدْعُ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرًا. Say, this is my path. Whose path? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His path, imagine that. If you are doing da'wah, you are following his path. ادعو إلى الله على بصيرة. You call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a clear way, with knowledge, with understanding, with wisdom. I mean, insight, you cannot even translate بصيرة. أنا ومن اتبعني. Me and those who follow me. وسبحانالله وما أنا من المشركين. And praise be to Allah. And I am not of those who associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a very strong statement. You are calling people with wisdom and you are stating that you are not someone who is a mushrik. Sometimes when we live, even in, you know, subhanAllah, in these in non-Muslim countries, we find that we need to, or we are faced with situations that we sometimes bend a little bit. And I witnessed this very sad situation actually in the University of Windsor, when someone, and I'm not going to say his name, it's not from the way of the people to say the names of and the mistakes of people, but just to learn from it. And he was asked a question by a Catholic. And the Catholic said, I'm a Catholic. Like, am I okay according to Islam? And his response, because he's scared that he's going to upset these people, there's many people there. He said, you are okay because the Quran says to you, Ahlul Kitab. The Quran calls you Ahlul Kitab. This is a person who's an Imam, who's been living here in the West for a long time. He has very good relations with non-Muslims. And we should. But there's limits. There's limits. We do not bend our deen. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in many verses, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَحْلِ الْكِتَابِ. Those who disbelieve who are kuffar from who? From the Al-Kitab. The same term that he used it as an excuse that they're okay. لَقَدْ كَفَرُوا الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهُ وَالْمَسِيحَ ابْنُ مَرْيَمَ. They have disbelieved. They're not okay, like at Amana, no, like at Kafar. We don't bend. Bob, John, Susie, we have been neighbors for a long time. Yes, Allah is one. This is Islam. We've been talking about this for a long time. So Muhammad, do you say that if I don't accept Islam after you told me what it is, I will go to hellfire? You can say, listen, I'm not Allah to say that you're going to, I don't know how you're going to die, but if you die as a non-Muslim after I told you, yes, I'm sorry to say that, but yes, you'll go to hellfire. But you can do something about it. So I had people who tell me, come and tell me, man, Islam is like the truth, but I don't know, I can't do it, you know. If there would be any religion for me to pick, it would be Islam. These kind of statements, and you're like, what are you doing, buddy? Just do it. Well, you know, I have some drinking problem. Forget about your drinking problem, man. There's, you know, just do the first step. You can worry about your drinking problem later on. But I have some girlfriend. Forget about your girlfriend right now. Be a Muslim. It's better to be a Muslim with girlfriend and drinking than not Muslim with girlfriend and drinking. Not that we're, you know, tell people to be with girlfriend and drinking. But we need to push these obstacles, these excuses that people are coming up with rejecting Islam. And we need to be firm, nice, smile, but firm. And we do not bend our deen. There's no such thing as religious pluralism in Islam. There's no such thing. One person has come and they said, there's a verse in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Jews and Christians are saved. And what, subhanAllah, even Muslims use this verse. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ هَادُوا وَالنَّصَارَى. Right? There's many different versions of the verse anyway. But those who are Jews and the Christians, okay? إن الذين آمنوا والذين حادوا النصارى الصابين. Okay, this is the verse. من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر. Okay, this is the verse. Different variations. There's about 5 or 6 verses in the Quran about the same with a bit different variation. That those who believe and who are Jews and Christians and Sabians, whoever believes in Allah on the last day and works righteous deeds, فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Right? There will be no fear on them and they will not suffer. And even Muslims say, see, Allah said that Christians, Jews are all good. I actually wrote a paper on this semester about a few weeks ago, about 15 pages or 10 pages, looking at the tafsir of this verse with ayah from the Quran. Who is إِنَّ الَّذِينَ حَادُوا? Who is إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَالَّذِينَ حَادُوا وَالنَّصَارَ وَالصَّابِينَ? Who are these people? Why does Allah use different terms for them? And without a shadow of the doubt, I've established in this paper that these people are those who are Muslims, who have become Muslims, who have submitted, who have turned to Islam. And Allah is just showing the different groups so there can be a difference, an established difference. These are not people who believe in the Aqidah of the Christians and of the Jews. These are Muslims. If anyone wants to get that paper, you can find it on online. So we cannot bend, brothers and sisters. Dawah is our responsibility. Dawah is actually the best thing we can do. And Allah tells us in another beautiful verse, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is the better? Who is better in speech than the one who calls to Allah and works righteous deeds and says, I am from the Muslims? I want you to pay attention to this ayah because it's very important. Because unfortunately, you have to understand that da'wah is a responsibility. And we will be questioned about it. Those who do da'wah, who have accepted this responsibility, have even a greater responsibility now. Because they're talking on behalf of the Anbiya. They're talking for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're calling people to Allah. And we find sometimes, unfortunately, that people who are in da'wah, they themselves don't apply these rulings to themselves. We find them being saying one thing and doing another. And this is causing for a lot of people problems. And that's what Allah says. مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا. That they call to Allah, but they do righteous deeds. You can't just call to Allah. You have to work. There's people who are calling to Allah and they can't park a car properly. There's people who are calling to Allah and they park in a handicapped spot when they don't have a handicapped permit. There's people who are calling to Allah and they're screaming at others and arguing all the time. And not smiling. And cheating on their taxes. And stealing. But they're calling to Allah. Allah is telling us, you cannot just do that, you need to do righteous deeds. And the best example we see in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's people who get very angry. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I give this advice to myself. SubhanAllah, it's very hard. But for a day, you'll be suffering, you'll be having to deal with so many people. Allah, just recently I got death threats from people. Just because you're in doubt. From so-called peace-loving Christians. The Prophet Muhammad has told us, has given us a very, very strong advice. This is for everyone. For parents, for husbands, for whoever working for Allah, you'll be tested. Specifically for that, those who are invited to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will have to deal with people that you feel like pulling your hair out of your head. Insulting Islam. Insulting Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A man came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Awsini, advise me, قال لا تغضب. He said, don't get angry. Subhanallah, this is one of the best advices that we can ever take. Awsini, give me advice. قال, he said, لا تغضب. Don't get angry. Again, لا تغضب. Don't get angry. Sometimes we flip out for no reason. We need to have this patience. This is a very big characteristic of a da'i. Very important. Now a lot of people might say, well, I'm a da'i, or I want to do da'wah, but I'm very sinful. Well, guess what? Everyone sins. This shouldn't make you stop. Actually, if you stop your da'wah, and you find that most people will say from, they don't do da'wah because of two things. They say, I don't have knowledge. We've already refuted that. بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ أَلَيَا. Okay, convey from me if it's I. We refuted that. And the second, they will say, I'm not good. I'm a sinner. And we can refute that from many, many ways. And first and foremost, we look that no one is perfect. And the Prophet said, كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَّأَ. That every son of Adam sins. وَخَيْرُ خَاطِئِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ. And the best of those who sin are those who make tawbah. And we find over and over, even sahabas, they did mistakes that did not stop them from their work. It did not stop them from their work. Da'wah, calling people to Islam, can be a means of forgiveness for us. Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, اِتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُ مَا كُنْتُ. Fear Allah wherever you are, wherever you can. وَأَدْبِي سَيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحَى. And follow bad deeds with good deeds. They erase them. وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. And deal with people in the best of manners, in a good manner. SubhanAllah. Look at this. Sometimes we spend hours in trying to figure out what to do, and one hadith can just give you the answer to everything that you need in your life. So look how short these hadith are. Look, the speech of Muhammad Hassan was the compressed or the gathered speech that had so much weight, but few words. And you'll find that the, you know, I've been talking now for about 20 minutes, and maybe you've got a little bit from it. But maybe two or three hadith that I've said here can really outset everything, and really weigh a lot, subhanAllah. So, brothers and sisters, I think we established a da'wah's obligation on every single one of us. How? Different means and different ways. Different people can do different things. Talk to your imam, talk to the da'is, the people who are doing. Whether it be you push the button on the camera to record with the right niyyah, can have a big, big reward. And why not? I've seen some of the best people, subhanAllah, working behind the scenes, cleaning and, you know, just carrying the cameras and just these kind of things. Okay, you can't do that? Type, give your money for someone who's doing da'wah. Okay, you can't do that? Type, write a book. Write a pamphlet. Do something. There's so many ways. The internet. Just anything, subhanAllah. It can reach people all over the world. You will be amazed how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to open the doors for you. And we need it. Wallahi, we need it. There are so many people who are inviting to other than Allah, using the best of means. And this is a theory that I have, that if you don't give da'wah, you're going to be given da'wah to. If you do not give da'wah, you will be given da'wah too. It's just the way it is. Especially living here. You're giving da'wah from every single side. We go to university, college. People are pushing their deen, their ways of life on us. And if they're not, we're seeing it, we're exposed to it. So if we're not calling people, they're calling us. Day and night. Whenever we turn on that TV, they're calling us. Whenever we're listening to that radio music, it's calling us. We need to call, or we'll be called. We've established that this is an obligation. How? There's many ways we can do it. The question is, will we do it? Will we do it? This is the question. And I said, I've seen Islah. Islah is very good. It's happening. But we need da'wah in Allah. Da'wah ila Islam. Da'wah li ghayr muslimin. The ones who are not Muslims. We need to call them to Islam. Now I'll take about 5 minutes and inshallah finish. Just to focus on one issue that is very important, and that is, okay, what after? What about after people have embraced Islam? And again, I found our community in the same stage with no proper program for new Muslims. The new Muslims, those who have embraced Islam, those who have said La ilaha illallah. And then what? What happens after? We all line up here, we've seen them. The Shaykh calls someone up. You know, say after me, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. We'll hear Takbir, Allahu Akbar. We'll line up, hug them. If you need anything, brother, please. And then what? Where are they? I've been in this community for 10 years. Many people have become Muslims. But at the masjid, we see Jibreel, Rob, Adamo, Kevin, a few other who have been, alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed them to be here and to stay with us. What about the other people? Where are they? Like, did we establish, did we try to make anything? Yes, we did. Wallahi, we did. Allah is my witness that I, when I was here, I tried. Many of the people in this masjid have tried. But it just doesn't work if their whole community is not behind them. We need to find a proper way to do it. And the way to do this, we need someone to take it upon themselves to go back and study the seerah of Muhammad, specifically the time of the hijrah, and then when the muhajireen and the ansar, when they established that brotherhood, and when the new Muslims, when the people used to come to Islam, and how this system was established. We need to study that and try to establish a system that is maybe somehow similar. It needs to be academically studied. Actually, there should be a fiqh al-Muslimin al-Judud that deals with the new Muslims. And inshallah, if Allah gives me life and enough strength in my studies, inshallah, for a master's later on, I will try to do this. This is my niyyah, to do with the scholars a book or a fiqh. How to approach them, what kind of tarbiyah, what kind of material, how to teach them, what should be the first thing, how the community should be structured, what kind of funds, how they should be taught salah, aqidah, how should it be, what dosage. This is very important because there have been people who have left Islam. This is the reality. There are people who have been really disenchanted with community and with people, the way sometimes people act, and they have, because when a new Muslim comes to Islam, they are thinking that they are going to be walking with the Sahaba. And none of us is Sahaba. This is the reality. But we can change that. We can train ourselves. We can be careful in how we deal with people. This can be done. There can be some tarbiyah. There can be some changes. But they will be very, very sensitive at the beginning, especially the first years. Allah will test them from different places. And this is the time that we need. And from proper experience, the first 2-3 years, I had some brothers who were with me almost 24 hours a day. They lived with me. They shared everything they had with me. And to be honest, I'll be very honest, and maybe some people might not agree with me on this. They did not push such a great amount of knowledge on me. And actually, when I looked into the seerah and the hadith and the way the life of the Sahaba, we find that within the first 3 to 5, even 10 years, some Sahabas have memorized a couple of surahs. They have learned parts of certain things. They took it step by step. And Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would teach them slowly. And they had people with them to love them, to care for them, to offer that spiritual support. And I found that it worked a lot with me because I was there with people who taught me how to pray, taught me basics, but didn't put an abundance of knowledge on me from different areas and different parts. They were basically just my brothers. And when the time came, alhamdulillah, the knowledge came slowly. But it seems that today when someone becomes a Muslim, right away, people will be like, you know, be careful with this, don't do that, this, that, let's go for this many days here, that many, you know, this and that, and, you know, you should do this, and you should look like that. And the person's like, it's just my first day of Islam, what should I do? Right? Come to this halaqa, that halaqa. And people get confused. And it becomes too much. And say, you know what, I need to unplug. It's just too much for me right now. I need to take a break. And when you take a break, Shaitan said, cha-cha, I got you. You'll be by yourself. He'll come to you and says, I think you did something wrong, man. How about you reconsider your conversion to Islam? And the little guy will say, yeah, man, it's just too much for me. I thought that Islam is simple. And they say, you know what, I need to take a break. And that break becomes a long break, and then it just becomes... And I have seen it, and you have seen it. And it's wrong for us to ignore it and to say that, well, you know what, there's no problem. Islam is the fastest growing religion in North America, right? We hear that, right? Did you know that it's also the fast apostatized religion? Has anyone ever told you that? If you talk to Sheikh Abdul Rahim Green in the UK, who heads IRA, he's one of the probably the strongest organizations and the most active and proactive and offensive, meaning offensive as they go out, organizations in the world right now. And you can tell you by statistics that Islam is the most left religion in the world. And the most converted too, yes, people come to, but they also leave as fast as they can. Because, and he, if he ever tells you anything, he can tell you that because there's no system of follow-up. I work with Dawah in Dubai, and it's the same problem there. Even though it's a Muslim country, still the follow-up is suffering. It's better than here, alhamdulillah, many more times, but still a big problem. Everywhere actually, even in Saudi. The only thing that the culture there is established is more Islamic, so people are still, somehow, it's easier for them. They don't have to deal with the same issues that they deal here. But still, this is a big problem, and we need to, as an ummah, to address this. Because those people will come on the day of judgment to us, they'll hold us by the necks. They'll come to us. They will come to us. Da'wah is, it's a must, brothers and sisters. It's just, we just need to do it. We need to support it. There can be some brothers who can, used to be a Da'wah Street program. Kevin knows that. This needs to be revived. We cannot let it go. Our community has to work with the MSA and the University of Windsor. Support them, to provide them with training, with resources. Alhamdulillah, we have brothers who are blessed in this community. We need to reach the people. We just, alhamdulillah, we acquired some camera from the masjid. Allah, Sheikh is a bahar, is a sea of knowledge. Put it on camera, put it on YouTube. Put it on YouTube. You will meet someone, you will not know after 2, 3, 4 years. Someone will message you and say, I became Muslim because of your brother. SubhanAllah. I had one person I can never forget. Imagine, you are in Canada and you're making a, it's not even a good lecture, SubhanAllah, about the Quran. And this person, you know what he was? He was an Ismaili. You know Ismaili? It's like, they're not Muslim. An Arab is a Lebanese Ismaili. And he said, like, if my family knows, they'll kill me. He said, because of your lecture on the authenticity of the Quran, He said, I became Muslim. And he's like, I've been trying to reach you for a year to just message you, to be able to communicate to you. SubhanAllah. When I reached that message, I was a very, very sad, you know, after, you know, I was just feeling very low. But when I read that, I mean, SubhanAllah, how can, you know, just a camera, just a YouTube, you can reach people all over. Someone should stand up and say, you know what, I will record these lectures, put them up on, you know, YouTube. It's very easy. This is a form of da'wah. But we need to do something. We need to work together. We need to establish a da'wah committee, something strongly. Abdul Qadir cannot do it by himself. I'm sorry. I see the same people, as I said, working always for Islam in this masjid, and they cannot do it. Some of you need to step up and say, you know what? Okay, I'll take it up. And I'm not saying you or you or you. You guys are doing enough. No, someone new has to stand up and say, hey, you know what? I'll press that button on the camera, and I'll press the upload button on the YouTube, and boom. That's it. Don't shake your head, bro. You're not gonna do it. You got enough things already. We need that. We need Allah, you need. So, and of course, with the new Muslims, please start something, do something. We were talking about establishing a full-time position for someone to deal with new Muslims specifically. Don't let that be extended to something else. It should be only specifically just for new Muslims. And even if you're just sitting there in an office, but you're available for them for 8 hours a day, this would be very, very important. Do not base it on, oh, no one's coming. Someone will come. Someone will come. And even if it's one person, this is more than enough. Do it. We have the resources. Do it. Don't let it fall down. Do it. Go to the imam. Go to the board. Propose it. Push it. Do it. It has to be done. It has to be done. There are people who need Islam. They're looking for Islam. Brothers can tell you, they stood in the street dawah. People are saying, where are you? We're waiting for you. We're waiting for this message. How come no one has ever told us before about this? Where are you? Where have you guys been? Really, brothers and sisters, we need to do something. This community is huge. We have a big community here. Huge community across the border into Michigan. Huge community. We're based, it's not even a country anymore, different countries, just 5 minutes across the bridge. We are huge. We're great numbers. Do something. It's impossible that we cannot get some kind of program. Even a course like between us and them. I mean, there's just so many messages there, so many organizations. Put aside the differences right now. We need to worry about certain things that are very important, priorities. We need to do that. Very, very important. There are resources, there are people, there is knowledge, there are many things. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and bless us. And I ask you for your forgiveness. I hope I didn't take too long. I just end, inshallah, with one advice from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if you take anything from this, course, the two hadith, okay? قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بلغوا عني ولو آية. Convey from me, even if it's why I am. Go and tell the Christians لا إله إلا الله قل هو الله أحد. Tell them, if it's the only thing you know, tell them, smile and say لا إله إلا الله. There's only one. There's no deity worthy of worship except Allah. Say Allah is one. And second hadith, as the Prophet himself said, and the man came and asked him, أَوْسِنِي قَالَ لَا تَغْضَبْ. Advise me. He said, don't get angry. These are the two advice that I leave you from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَجِزَاكُمْ خَيْرٌ سُبْحَانَكَ وَبِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. If I said anything wrong, this is only for myself. Anything good is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakallah.